Good morning, sir. So we are from MBA Bankers Group and we have a project on bank diversity. So we wanted to take your interview. So can you provide us your information about yourself?
I am Rahul Prabhu Khanolkar. I work as a coordinator and head of the department for post-graduation in environmental sciences in UBS College. We are affiliated to Rani Chennamma University in Belgaum. Before joining here, I was working as a freelance consultant in environment, ecology, management, and sustainability. And along with that, with few industries, and I also worked on few conservation-related projects in northern Westerlands, especially on the lesser-known fauna, the less charismatic species, which don't receive any priority in conservation. So, few projects related to that.
Thank you, sir, for giving us your time. Can you provide us an interview of your background and expertise in the field of biodiversity and conservation?
Okay, so I have been for almost more than a decade now. I've been working on various projects related to natural resource management and also eliciting people's support at ground level for conservation action. So there are various parts. One is developing that sensitivity or awareness in the community who will actually do those actions for conservation of a species. That is one part. To start that action or to convince people, also to convince government or the administration, you need a strong scientific database what conservation actions need to be taken. So gathering that data on field. Now to gather that data on various types of organisms, your methods are also different. For conservation of plants, your methodology will be different. For conservation of a large species like tiger or elephant, your observations that you need from ground or the methods or the management practices that you suggest may be different. If your conservation project is about conserving the species of ant, the methodology is completely different. The suggestions that you take, those will be different. So I have been working on various teams and projects doing sort of some parts in all these things, working with government, working with research organizations, and also working with people. I'm trying to integrate all of them together, bring them on one table so that everybody understands what needs to be done. Otherwise, in conservation, what problems we face is somebody decides something that people should do this management practice, let's stop cutting trees. That decision is being made in Delhi. But people in Belgaum or people in some village in Khanapur Taluka, they don't understand why you should not cut, because their livelihood, their lifestyle depends on that. So bringing all of them together, also suggesting alternatives and asking you not to cut a tree, what other source of fuel or energy or material I'm providing you. So all these things need to happen in the body. So my work, consultancy as well as direct implementation is in all this. Aspects.
What inspired you to pursue a career in biology, particularly in the study of biodiversity?
Since my school days, I was interested in nature, but at that time, access to internet, also technology like Android phones and various Android apps, that was not there. So we only depended on various field guides and books, those existed there. Even those books were not available at cheaper prices. So just observing whatever we could see in nature, of course at that time we did not understand what we were looking at or what was the importance of that. But then slowly, even in college I was more interested in biology. So because of that, after BSc I pursued a master's degree in environmental science. Then along with that I also did a certificate course in ornithology, that is science of birding. A postgraduate diploma then in natural resource management and sustainability. And also to learn advanced techniques, I did a course in geographical information systems. So creating maps, analyzing spatial data sets, all those things. And so to resolve that curiosity, once you start observing more, you get more questions. But then to get answers, you start moving in the nature more frequently. You really start reading more. You have more interactions with the experts who are in that field. And then your field observations combined in that, then that really helps.
Yes.
But basically, if you like nature, if you are curious, if you like understanding those complex interlinkages between species and how they are linked to environment, like curiosity triggered all this.
So how would you define biodiversity and why is it important for the health of our planet?
Okay, biodiversity, general definition everyone knows, that's the diversity in all the life forms. So theoretically we have three levels in biodiversity. One is genetic diversity, then we have species diversity, and then ecosystem diversity. So genetic diversity is, though we all are same species, Homo sapiens sapiens, each one is unique, each one has a unique set of DNA. If we look at the genetic diversity in this room also, we have lots of genetic material which is diverse. So that in all other species, in birds also, in animals, mammals, plants, though they belong to same species, because of the genes that we carry, our behavior, our external appearance, the way we talk, the way we move, all these things are different. The strength we have, now strength is also different. Mental strength is different, physical strength is different, all that comes from our genetics. So that is our genetic diversity that we have. Species is different number of species, different organisms that we have. And then different types of ecosystem all that exist. And why diversity of life is required? So each species or each individual, if you are same species or different species, in any natural system has some specific role to play. And that role has come with the process of evolution. Even if you have a species of ant or a species of spider, what is that ecological role or ecological service that they provide? It may not be useful for humans because we always look at things with an anthropocentric approach. If this is useful to me, I am going to protect it or conserve it. Naturally, that doesn't happen. So that role of our species may not be important for humans. But in the entire system, in ecological cycles, biogeochemical cycles, ecological processes, they play a very important role. Because we don't understand that, we don't give importance to even the smaller creatures. But entire, if you look at balance in all the systems, all biogeochemical cycles, everything is dependent on diversity of life. And if one species goes extinct, or even if one species is threatened, that can create imbalance in the entire system. Right now, for example, all bees are facing problems and all bee species are threatened because of maximum use of insecticides and pesticides. If bees are lost or if their population drops down, we will face problems in our horticulture, agriculture, because bees are the most important pollinators that we have. So that's why understanding what diverse life forms we have, how they are useful, what way they are playing their role, that is very important.
Can you share some examples of the different level of biodiversity, like genetic species and ecosystem, and explain their significance?
This I have already said. But always we need to understand that in schools and any where we try to depict diversity, usually that is depicted by a pyramid. So you have autotrophs, then heterotrophs, then consumers, and man is put at the top. But that is not actual case. Actually, it's a kind of horizontal system. We get a notion that because man is at the top of the pyramid, man is the most important organism. That is not the case. All species that are on Earth, who have survived for the last millions of years, everyone is equally important. And we need to understand that, appreciate that, and then once we realize the importance of all the species, usually our behavior, the way we think, how sensitive we are, all these things start changing.
What are the major threats to biodiversity worldwide and what role do humans play in these threats?
At global level, climate change, global warming is definitely one, but along with that, habitat destruction is also one. We are destroying the places or habitats where these organisms have evolved and they are living there for so many years. So destruction of those habitats, along with destruction also habitat fragmentation, cutting the habitat between two parts or four parts. Cutting as in, if you have a large patch of forest, I build a national highway from the middle. So that national highway is dividing that forest in two parts. So animals from one part are not able to move to the other. So that is habitat fragmentation. Along with that, changing land use patterns. That is also one threat. So earlier you might have a forest ecosystem that exists here, but now I have cut that forest and converted that into an agriculture patch. So that is conversion of land. That is also a major threat. Along with that, for biodiversity, illegal trade, hunting, poaching, those are also important threats in our region. Also in parts of Africa, also in parts of Southeast Asia, South Asia, because of our implementation of rules and regulation for conservation protection, that is not done efficiently. That's why hunting poaching is also an important thing. Along with that, for certain species of organisms, smuggling and illegal trade, that is also an important thing. Because people want to keep you animals as a pet in a closed environment or in a fish tank. Different species are kept. Butterflies, snakes, frogs, small mammals, lizards. There is demand for a lot of organisms worldwide.
So could you discuss some successful biodiversity conservation initiatives or projects that you have been involved and are aware of?
Okay. So my work is also on bat diversity, bat ecology and conservation. You know, bats, the nocturnal flying mammals that we have. So the work I was doing last year, I received a small grant from the United Kingdom for assessment and conservation of bats in northern Western Ghats, especially in a region where these three states, Karnataka, Goa and Maharashtra, these three states where they meet. That region is Tilari bioregion. So in Tilari, we did an assessment of bats, what species we have, what are their major roosting sites, also what kind of ecological services they are providing, and how we can conserve them in that region. That was the most recent project that we did. And in that, again, there was field component where we move in forest areas, different types of habitats. So the major threat to Tilari region is large scale monoculture plantations. Monoculture is like you select one species of plant and in hundreds of acres you only do plantation of that species. So when you have such large monocultures, how that affects bat diversity? That was one part. Along with that, for monitoring of bat species, so like bird calls that we hear, bird songs, we don't know how bat calls are there because they are non-audible. Bats use ultrasonic sound frequencies for their navigation and to find their food items. So we were also doing work on recording their calls using ultrasound bat detectors. So bat detectors, what they do is they record these ultrasonic frequencies, convert that into audible sound, and then we are able to hear that. So each species, we recorded calls of those species, analyzed them using acoustic softwares. So once we know what species calls at what frequency, in future that helps in monitoring all the landscape. Was one. And then simultaneously for conservation action, we did programs on capacity building of nature enthusiasts who are in those areas, capacity building of forest staff who are actually working on ground and doing the conservation action, and also to build awareness in the school children in those villages in that area. So making people understand what is the importance of bats, how to study bats. If bats are not present, what can go wrong? If bats are threatened, if the populations in that region is declining, what problems human community will start facing? What will happen in our agriculture? How our horticultural production will go on reducing? And to stop that, how to conserve bats? All this entire process was done for almost 2 years after the pandemic was over. So that was the recent one where I was involved. And previous to that, then I also worked on tracking large mammal movement in parts of Karnataka and Goa by installing camera traps and at key locations, and then the camera traps automatically record all the movements of mammals or any animals in front of the camera. So it has either infrared sensor or movement sensor. So any animal with heat in their body, if it is moving in front of that camera, it will take a video and photo. Or if the camera has a motion sensor, anything moves in front of the camera, it will record it. So we are installing these camera traps in a grid pattern. So to cover an area of 100 square kilometers, we have installed about 10 camera traps. So one camera trap for each 10 square kilometers. It was recording all the mammal movement in that location for that particular time duration. So you understand which species are there, what population is there, and then if those animals are they going to move away from that protected area, go to towards a village, start attacking on livestock, or they can then, or this data can also help in reducing human and wildlife conflict. So, but to have suggestions, to have any kind of solutions, we need this ground data for any biodiversity project. Understanding how these animals are living, what problems they are facing, why they are behaving in such a way. After we understand that, then we can suggest or come up with solutions.